gazing at people, some hand in hand. Just what I'm going through, they can understand. Some try to tell me thoughts they cannot defend. Just what you want to be, you will be in the end, and I love you.
This video and all my works are not to prompt you to hate. They are to educate and eradicate the lies taught by the state. It is to help you prepare for our final fate as we await Jesus to storm through the gate and set all things straight. Psalms 12:2 says, "They speak falsehood to one another with flattering lips, and with a double heart they speak." Currently, folks, there is a great deception about the subject of Israel and prophecy. There are literally thousands of books on the subject of Israel, Israelites, and prophecy. Hollywood, the churches, the media, and social media more than do their parts to conceal the truth and promote the lie. It's amazing how the liars keep saying the same thing about Israel and prophecy, and nobody ever realizes that these liars, with their books and their movies and their YouTube videos about prophecy in Israel, none of their predictions or their prophecy ever comes true. You see, because if you're basing your prophecy and your in your Bible knowledge on the Israelites and you don't know who they are, how can you ever understand the scripture? The people of this world are lost in a maze and cannot find their way out. This is Babylon, putting people in a maze. The only way out of this demonic maze, out of the Babylonian maze and deceit, is through Jesus Christ. In our modern world, many people and religious factions firmly believe they are the chosen of the Creator. This does not bother me, nor should it bother you. For those of us who value true freedom, we know this is freedom in one of its purest forms, the right to worship and believe as we see fit. The vast majority of the church-going world and even many other religions believe they know the chosen people of the Bible. Now, it does not matter if they've never read the Bible, or in some cases they read just enough to know that if they go further, their illusions will be shattered. You see, we have to be honest and acknowledge that the majority of the people who claim that they know who the true Israelites are, they've never read the Bible. They don't know the Bible. They don't use the Bible. And in the modern world, people do not read the Father's Word. They will not open up a 1611 King James Bible and read it. They just won't do it. I wish Christians could understand how utterly embarrassing they have become. They have been neutered mentally, physically, and spiritually. The brainwashing runs deep, folks. Now, you would think that the people who claim to love the God of the Bible and love Jesus Christ would at least know a fragment of what's in His holy word. More to the point, you would expect them to know who the Israelites are. But they don't. Currently, there are a handful of groups and peoples that promote themselves as the Israelites of the Bible, better known as God's chosen people. Again, I don't have a problem with anybody saying they're God's chosen people. However, if we are using the Bible as proof, then shouldn't we at least be willing to read the book and then make our decision based on what's in the book? Jews claim they are God's chosen people. They say they are the ancient Israelites of the Bible. Fair enough. There is a movement by black people called the Black Hebrew Israelites. They claim that Africans and Native Americans are the lost tribes of Israel. Fair enough. However, I don't see Native Americans, quite frankly, beating that drum. But fair enough. There is also a movement called Christian or Kingdom Identity, in which some people claim that all white people are the lost tribes of Israel. Fair enough. Now, not all of them can be right because they're getting their knowledge, or at least they're coming to their conclusion, but it should be based on the Holy Scriptures. However, it could be possible that all of them, every single one of them, are wrong. The answers are in the Bible. The problem is, again, the people who make the claims will not read the Bible, and or they lie about what's in the Bible to weave their lies of deceit, or they suffer from sheer ignorance of our Father's Word. These people are the epitome of 2 Timothy 3:7. They are ever learning and never able to learn the truth. Ever learning and never able to learn the truth. The answer to the mystery of the lost tribes of Israel is not even complicated. In fact, it's incredibly simple to solve if we will read the Bible. Now, what I'm going to do, brethren, is open up the scriptures and I'm going to read to you and I'm going to let you draw your own conclusion. Now, I could easily make this video 3 or 4 hours and read to you hundreds of verses that undeniably prove who the Israelites of the Bible are. Why make a teaching complicated when it doesn't have to be? So what we're going to do is simply read about 30 to 40 verses, and we're going to let Jesus Christ talk. And then you're going to have to put some work in yourself. I'm going to show you quite a few verses, and you are going to have to study the word to show thyself approved, is what your Father said. You don't need approval from man, but you do need to be approved by your Father. So if you can, if you can prove that I'm wrong and if I'm in error, if you can, I will apologize and admit that I'm wrong, that I'm in error. So what we're going to do, folks, is we're just going to read. That's all we're going to do. We're just going to read, and I will let you draw your own conclusions. Again, there is no hate here. We're not going to dog anybody. We're simply going to read the Bible. That's all we're going to do. I'm not going to go off on a tangent and scream because I don't do that. We're simply going to read the scripture and let you and your discernment tell the truth. So for those who follow my work, you know that I do not mention or reference our race or color much. I don't. And I don't do it because the war that we're in, it's a more of a spiritual war. And the spirit that dwells in us is more important than our pigmentation. And we also know that the Bible says that we will be changed in the twinkling of an eye. We won't have bodies. We won't have flesh suits any longer. However, since the doubters and the naysayers and the people want to go against my Father, they like to use color, then I'll go there just briefly just to prove a point. Let's see what the scriptures say with regards to the skin color of Jesus and the Israelites. If you go back to King David and his son Solomon, that's all you need. In 1 Samuel 16:12 and in 1 Samuel 17:42, the verses are describing David. It describes him, and you can read it for yourself, as ruddy, and also he was quite beautiful and goodly to look at. So he's described as ruddy and of a fair countenance. What does that mean? Well, I've already told you what it means. But for more proof, we can go to Song of Solomon 5:10, and this is David's son Solomon. My beloved is white and ruddy, the chiefest among 10,000. Now, this is not a symbolic statement. It's simply saying that the man was white. All right. Now, in Revelation 1:14, many people will use these verses to prove that somehow Jesus Christ was black. This is fallacy. In Revelation 1:14, it says, his head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire. The verse is simply using wool as a reference to color, not texture. In this context, white is symbolic for pure, sinless, and without spot. And his eyes of fire are symbolic for truth. For example, when you hear somebody in the scriptures, he's on fire, that means that he's telling the truth. So that's what you have with Jesus Christ there. Has absolutely nothing to do with skin color. In Revelation 1:15, it says, and this is the verse that they use to really hammer home their point, but again, they don't understand the Father's word. And his feet like unto fine brass, as if burned in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. When brass is put in a furnace, folks, it glows white. Now, why is Jesus' feet brass here? It's symbolic for power, for strength. You see, strength. And I'm giving you two verses here in 1 Kings and Ezekiel 1:7 that brass glows. And then in Daniel 2:32, when Daniel is describing this beast, the beast is described as his head was of fine gold, his breast and arms of silver, and his belly and thighs of brass. It's symbolic, people. It's symbolic for strength. So that's what you have there. It's describing Jesus being pure, telling the truth, and being strong. Has nothing to do with skin color. More symbolism with fact. Lamentations chapter 4, verses 7 through 8. Her Nazarites were purer than snow. They were whiter than milk. They were more ruddy in body than rubies. Their polishing was of sapphire. Now, these were the Nazarites. They were Israelites. They were white. However, in the very next verse, they became black. Well, how does that happen? Because it's symbolic. Listen, their visage is blacker than coal. They are not known in the streets. Their skin cleaveth to their bones. It is withered. It has become like a stick. What does that mean? It means they're starving. It's a famine. You see, black is symbolic in the scriptures for mourning and suffering. That's what it has. It has nothing to do with skin color. Lamentations 5:10. Our skin was black like an oven because of the terrible famine. Joel 2:6, before their face the people shall be much pained, all faces shall gather blackness. It means everybody's going to suffer, everybody's going to mourn. This is why at funerals people are supposed to wear black. Black is symbolic for mourning, suffering, and pain. All right, that's all it is. That's what it really means. Has nothing to do when you read these verses with skin color. Or you see, if you can't take everything that you read in the Bible literally. Because if you do, you would have to take Daniel 12:10, many shall be purified and made white. What does that mean? They're all of a sudden going to turn white? No, it means they're going to be made pure. I've told you folks since day one that much of the Bible is symbolic, and this is why folks cannot comprehend its mysteries. Folks read the Bible literally, and this is why they get confused about Jesus, heaven, hell, and so much more. They're reading it literally, man. It is a gift from God Almighty, when you can truly understand what is being talked about in the scriptures. You have to know the difference between what is symbolic and what is literal. Let's continue. The part of the scriptures that folks, especially the churchgoers, love to use to justify their argument about God's chosen people is Genesis 12, verses 1 through 3. And the only way that you can make this the only way they can make this fit their narrative is to annihilate the holy word of the Father, the God that they claim that they believe in. In Genesis chapter 12, it says this, verses 1 through 3. Now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse them that curseth thee. And in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Now, these are the three verses that the blind Christians hold on to so dearly. They believe that this proves that the Jews are the chosen people of God and that we should serve and protect the state of Israel so God will bless us. And if not, they say that God will curse us. Now, let me just say something to you folks. You just read it. Do you see the word Jew there anywhere? No. No, the word Jew does not appear in the scriptures until 2 Kings 16:6. Abraham was a Hebrew. He was a Heber. Has nothing, brethren, to do with Jewish people. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Now, this is not being rude or this is not being hateful. It's just not there. Well, let me explain to you what's really going on here, too. Now, I'm not going to do a teaching about Ishmaelites or Keturah or Hagar. But I tell you, what people don't understand here is because the people that know the truth about it, they're afraid of it. Abraham and his wife, Sarah, are our ancestors. Now, they were to have their names changed to Abraham and Sarah, from Abram and Sarai. And in these two would come Isaac, who would give us Jacob, who had his name changed to Israel. And this was to be the blessed children of the Almighty Father through this man, Isaac. Now, Sarah could not have a baby in the beginning. You see, before her and Abraham had Isaac, she could not have a baby. Abraham took other women and had other children, other seeds. And guess what? The father even blessed them. Now, after Sarah died in Genesis 25, guess what? Abraham took more wives and had more children. More children. And guess what? The father blessed them. Now, if you're looking for this other family of Abraham, look no further than Palestine, Jordan, Lebanon, Iran, Iraq, Turkey, Syria, North Africa, and you will find them. You see, they live between what's called the Nile and the Euphrates. Is this making sense to you? Now, if you want to read it for yourself, read Genesis chapter 12 through 26, and you will understand it. But let's read it further here. It says, I will make thee a great nation, and I will bless thee. I will make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing, and I will bless them that bless thee, and curse them that curseth thee, and in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Now, I humbly ask the people who claim to be Israelites, where is your great nation? Explain to me how the earth and all the families have been blessed because of you. You see, right here it says Israel is to be a great and mighty nation, not once, but multiple times. Now, where are your mighty nations and your company of nations? Well, how about these countries and everything that came from them? The United States and Canada, Europe and all the countries that came from them, Scandinavia, the countries that came from them, Russia, Australia, South Africa, Greece, New Zealand. You see, we are looking at, excuse me, starting to go hoarse, we are looking at dozens upon dozens of nations, as in mighty nations. Now, humbly again, I ask those who say they are Israelites, where are your nations? I just showed you mine. Those are mine. That's my family. And I'm being humble. That's my people. Where are yours? The people called Israel walked this world and made nation after nation as God promised. Now, how could any believer refute this? I'll tell you why. Because the majority of churchgoers, as I've told you, they love the devil far more than they do love Jesus Christ. How about more proof? I tell you what, before we go further, I've got to get something to drink, and then we're going to go even deeper. All right, forgive me. I'm back. Okay, folks, we're going to go deeper. I was very parched there. For many of us, Jesus the Christ is the final authority. And Matthew 28:18 says that Jesus Christ has all power. So why do you think the churchgoers will not hear his word when it comes to the Israelites of the Bible? Why do they ignore what Jesus Christ tells us about the Israelites? Because Jesus Christ certainly tells us who are not the Israelites. All right? So let's go deeper, and we'll give all the glory to our Father through Jesus Christ. I think Jesus had at his disposal the history of past, present, and future when he said the following. In John chapter 10, Jesus the Christ says, I am the good shepherd, and know my sheep, and am known of mine. In 23 it says, And Jesus walked in the temple of Solomon's porch. Then came the Jews round about him, and said unto him, How long dost thou make us to doubt? If thou be the Christ, tell us plainly. Jesus answered them, I told you, and ye believe not. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. 26. But ye believe not, because ye are not of my sheep, as I said unto you. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. So Jesus Christ has just told them, they are not his sheep. Now, if you were a true believer in the Almighty Father through his precious Son, Jesus Christ, you could shut the Bible and say, the Jews are not God's chosen people. They're not the Israelites. Because Jesus Christ just told us so. That's not enough for the churchgoers, again, because I'm telling you, they do not really love Jesus Christ. They don't. They say they do with their mouth. As Paul said, they give lip service, but they really don't love him deep down. And he knows this. And for this, the punishment that they're going to get is far more dark and painful than what I can put into words. Now, let's turn our attention to one of the greatest verbal jousting matches in history. The Pharisees believed they could outduel the King of Kings. Let's recount this ancient saga, and we're going to turn to John chapter 8. And we're simply going to read the words of our beloved King. They understood not that he spake to them of the Father, Then said Jesus unto them, When ye have lifted up the Son of Man, then shall ye know that I am he, and that I do nothing of myself, but as my Father hath taught me, I speak these things. Amen. And he that sent me is with me, for the Father hath not left me alone, for I do always those things that please him. As he spake these words, many believed on him. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, If ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Jesus the Christ has lured them into a trap, and he did this for us. Now this should be proof enough. What's coming up? Pay attention. 33, they answered, We be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? You see, Jesus just destroyed the myth of Jews as God's chosen people called the Israelites. The real Israelites people were in bondage not once, not twice, but three times. Once in Egypt, once in Assyria, and once in Babylon. Now the Jews have just said, we were never in bondage. Jesus already told them, you're not my sheep. That should be enough. You see, that should be enough, but it's not. Because the churchgoers will simply omit this, or they will say that we're not taking it right. Really? We're not taking it right? I think we're taking it right on. Continuing in John 8, Jesus Christ was not done. He goes on to tell them five times they have a different father, you see. He calls him Abraham's seed in chapter 37, but he tells them that they're not Abraham's children, you see. In 41, he tells them, ye do the deeds of your father, your father. He tells them they have a different father. In 44, he tells them, ye are of your father, the devil. And the lust of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. Now, brethren, if Jesus Christ told any people on this earth that their father was the devil, would you believe they were God's chosen people? Now, I'm asking Jewish people. Because, you see, many Jewish people know the truth. And this is why many Jewish people, they don't acknowledge the Bible. They don't. And I can have more respect for somebody being honest than somebody that's trying to live a lie. In John 8:47, Jesus says, He that is of God heareth God's word. Ye therefore hear them not, because ye are not of God. In Matthew 23:35, he told them they are responsible for all the righteous blood spilled upon the earth. In Revelation 2:9 and 3:9, Jesus Christ called him the synagogue of Satan. Now, is this hate speech? Brethren, I haven't uttered not one word of hate speech. I've simply read the Bible. These are the words of Jesus Christ. So we can see that these are not the house of Israel or Judah. They're just not. Right? Deuteronomy 32:26. This is so key, brethren. Listen to what I'm telling you here. I would make the remembrance of them to cease from among men. You see, the Almighty Father is going to take away your identity. You see, he's going to strip it away from you. You're not going to know who you are until the very end. The Israelites are to become scattered to the four corners of the earth, and then their identity would cease from remembrance among men. The Israelites themselves would lose memory of the land and peoples from whence they originated. And over time, other nations and races would not know you as Israelites either. The origin of the Israelites would be a mystery for thousands of years, seemingly without an original point of origin, hence the phrase, lost tribes of Israel. We've never been lost. Our Father has always known where we were. The deliberate deception by the children of the devil to conceal true Israel has kept the children of the Father from knowing who they are. And this is exactly what our Father said would happen, and he always fulfills his promises. You must remember, brethren, you do have enemy and adversary, but much of what happens to us individually and collectively has to do with our behavior. This is why I'm always telling you to pray, to wake up every day and to serve your Father. Every day. Deuteronomy 28:43-44. The stranger that is within thee shall get up above thee very high, and thou shalt come down very low. Think about the time now. He shall lend to thee, and thou shalt not lend to him. He shall be the head, and thou shalt be the tail. The head is today's non-Israelites and the other forces that are under the control of Babylon. Our people are always being punished for turning our back on our Father. Think of the Federal Reserve. Think of banking. Think of the media. Think of the power that is, and they have brought everybody else with them above you and put you at the very bottom. The only way to change that is through Jesus Christ. Deuteronomy 28:68. And this has been used by black people too, and I think many of them, I don't think they're doing it with evil intentions. I just think they simply don't know scripture. They take this verse and they think that it applies to themselves about slavery. But if you read the verse, it has absolutely nothing to do with Africans. It has to do with Israelites. Deuteronomy 28:68, and the Lord shall bring thee into a new Egypt with ships. By the way whereof I spoke unto thee, thou shalt see it. And no more again, and there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen. But no man shall buy you. No man shall buy you. This very verse foretells the Israelites coming to America as indentured bondmen and bondwomen under contract until payment was fulfilled. They sold their labor by contract to the rich for the exchange of passage. And what it was, you had all these people in Europe, especially England, Scotland, Ireland, trying to get here to the Promised Land. And upon arriving here in the new land as indentured people, the Father says that no man will buy us. Why? Because the Father owns us. You see, Jesus Christ bought us with his blood. You see, and it's amazing that people will try to say that this is black people, this is Israelite people. All you simply have to do is read the verse in its context. No man shall buy you. Israel to have a new language. The scriptures by which means that our Father speaks now to us is not Paleo Hebrew. It's English. Now there is a new version of Hebrew called Yiddish. It's not ancient Hebrew. It's not even close. All right. Israel to have a new religion, a new covenant. We are Christians now. Okay. Christendom. We have a new covenant. We have the New Testament. Israel to colonize and spread abroad. Israel to colonize the desolate places of the earth. Israel's home to be invincible to outside forces. Nobody has invaded Israelite countries. We always fought amongst one another. And if you wanted to destroy Israel, you had to do it from the inside. This is why now we should not have a wall. It's disrespectful to have a wall because we are supposed to be an unwalled country, towns, and villages. Do you understand? God is our protection. We don't need walls. When we're doing right by the Father, we're not supposed to have walls. Israel to be undefeatable, defended by God. Israel to be God's instrument in destroying evil. Israel to be envied and feared by all nations. Israel to have a new name. You see, yes, we were to lose our old identity and gain a brand new name. What are we now? We are Christians, followers of Jesus. Some of us are. Israel is to live in the islands and the coast of the earth. Most of us have roots in what's called the British Isles. And if you look at all Western cultured countries, people flock to the coast. Israel was to have great agricultural harvest and wealth. The Almighty Father said that we would be blessed with agricultural prosperity, bountiful crops, productive lands, and mineral resources in abundance. God will give unto the Israelites the dew of the heaven and the fatness of the earth with plenty of corn, wine, wheat. The breadbasket of the world is what their lands would become. In fact, in the 60s, five states in the United States, known as the breadbasket of the world, could feed the entire world. That is a blessing from Almighty God, brethren. The Israelite European peoples, especially of America and Canada, have been the world's most successful farmers, and it's not even close. Israelites have a natural desire to grow things. They have to put their hands in the dirt. They love to work in the dirt. It's a gift. It's from the Father. Cattle, milk, honey, and so many other foods are staples of the Israelites. Our families carry those into Europe, Scandinavia, and all parts of the earth. There are many folks, non-Israelites, who cannot eat and drink the same foods as we can. Their bodies are not tolerant to it. Just as other families on this earth get diseases that we do not, because we are a distinct and separate people. We have always been miners of the earth. We have taken the minerals from the earth and used them for progress. Look at the United States of America and the great wealth that was in the ground. The Father gave this to us. All throughout history, other people on this earth have been merchants and farmers, but they were always poor farmers. Even with an abundance of fertile land, other nations and races would still have the majority of their people starving. This is a reality. Israel was to be the Almighty Father's battle axe, God's battle axe, an undefeatable military power. The Israelite people have produced the greatest soldiers and conquerors: Joshua, David, William the Conqueror, George Washington, Robert E. Lee, MacArthur, Patton. And we must remember that it was the Visigoths and the Romans of the Israelite people that defeated the hordes of Attila the Hun when no other nation could stop them. You see, it's the Israelite people, the Israelites, that were to conquer the heathen, the battle axe. And the battle axe was the great weapon and the symbolic weapon of the Saxon and the Germanic peoples. If not for the Christian crusaders, the ancient Mohammedans would have controlled Christendom a long time ago. Israel was to be a great seafaring and colonizing people. Throughout history, the world's greatest shipbuilders and seamen have been the Israelites. From the Vikings, the great navies of the English and Spanish right up to today, to the American Navy, the Israelites have ruled the seas, just as our Father said that we would. You see, because it is through ships and sea navigation that the Israelite people have spread, and that they got so much wealth through trade. They were the first and the only people to be great seamen, and the ancient explorers, the great ones, were always Israelites: Leif Erikson, Marco Polo, Magellan, Captain Cook. This is how your family spread around this earth, and it was prophesied thousands of years ago. Now, of course, many of the blessings bestowed upon the Israelite race have been lost or diminished due to disobedience to God, but this was prophesied too. And also, it is worth noting here that in the last days, as we're seeing now, every tribe, tongue, and nation would rise against Israel. And you're seeing it now. We are absolutely hated. But out of this hate is going to come glory, because many people that have walked away from the Father are going to run back to Him. They're going to run back to Him crying, screaming, "Please, Father." It's part of your Father's plan. Live this way, yet we mostly live by the uniforms and the vessels that we wear in this world, and that is our flesh. Our Father gave us obstacles. He gave us adversaries, both physical and spiritual. He gave them power, and He gave us power. Yet we do not recognize the power that He gave us. You know, many folks spend a whole lot of time talking about the power of the enemy, but they do not talk about the power that their Creator and their Father gave them. Maybe that's because many of them profess Jesus with their mouth, but they would rather talk more about the enemy and the evil of this world than they do the Father and Jesus. And for this, they do not have this gift. They do not have that power. The power that He gave us comes from Him. It is the ultimate power when we use it and we live by it. We are surrounded by people and beings that we cannot relate to. And frankly, we are not supposed to relate to them, brethren. We are not like them. They are not like us, and we are not like them. We are the aliens. This is their world, not ours. Jesus said to Pontius Pilate, "My kingdom is not of this world, nor are we of this world." Jesus said, "Many are called, but few are chosen." There are others that are aliens, just like us. However, they have joined this world. They have conformed to this world. They no longer see themselves as aliens. They see themselves as a part of this world. These people were called and given the chance, and they failed. They failed to walk this final mile and to receive the crown that has been promised to you. We must learn to live in spirit. The Bible tells us that we are in spiritual warfare. Ephesians chapter 6 speaks of this spiritual warfare. We are all spirit beings. We are learning how to live in the spirit. If we can live in the spirit, we can deny our flesh that is corrupt and the flesh that seeks the pleasures and the lust of this world. It is your flesh that seeks the cares and the things of this world that have no relevance in your walk or your life. Part 2, unbridled power. As we watch that ad, let me ask you something. Can you identify with that person in that ad? Do you believe the spirit of your father, the gift that we just spoke of, do you believe that that spirit lives in him? Do you believe he has a real relationship with the Son of the Almighty Father, Jesus the Christ? With so much evil and folks being scared and confused and more, we must ask ourselves, who's running the world? Who's really running the world? Now, I'm not filled with hate toward people. In fact, in my time on Google, I've been labeled as something that I'm not. People try to make me out to be, this has been going on for a while, this is what the enemy does. The enemy that our Father created, they label folks who tell the truth. They try to say that you're this, you're that, you're hate-filled, you're racist, you're this, you're that. I can get along with any and everybody. However, there are some folks that my Father has told me to avoid. I'm not hate-filled. I don't care if they're black, Jewish, brown, yellow. It just doesn't matter to me. I can get along. I can be polite. I can be respectful. If you try to hurt me or if you try to take away from the life that my Father has given me, then I am going to confront you. There are folks from all over this earth, brethren, that love Jesus, and they are aliens too. They have been given this by what? The Spirit. They may come from the Philippines. They may come from the islands in the Pacific. They may come from Brazil. They may come from any and everywhere. They have been given this spirit too, and it has been offered to all people besides the Israelites. However, there are people that walk this earth among you that are pure evil. There are blind and lost people who will never be brought to the truth. Matthew 15:13, everything that my Father did not plant will be rooted up. Because every man or woman, the child that walks this earth, does not come from God. In fact, most of them do not have this spirit that I am talking to you about today. I do not have the right to condemn anyone, brethren. I don't. There are many points in our lives when we were lost doing absolutely nothing to please our Father. In fact, for me personally, I spent many years being filthy and doing abominations in my Father's sight. With that in mind, let us remember that all of us, through his mercy, were brought to the truth. And it was done through our spirit, not the flesh. Good people, listen to me. You are living and you are going to die in all likelihood. Now, there will be some of us alive when Jesus the Christ returns for his own. Some will be alive. This life is here today and gone tomorrow. It is fleeting. We get old fast. And we get smart slow. This is the way it truly is. The evil and nonsense of this corrupt world is meaningless to you and I when we really come to the truth and understand what it's really about. We are here to be good sons and good daughters and to move forward. We are witnesses. We are ambassadors. We have been given a mission. That's what we are here for. Now, we come from a long line of people who have lived, built, died, fought, cried, and went through it all. And they are waiting to be judged, just as we will be. They are waiting on their commander-in-chief, Jesus the Christ. The cares of this world, for the most part, are mere illusions with fancy wrappers from the devil's children. In the world that we live in today, if a man or a woman or a child was to sit down and watch what they call the tell evil vision for one day, their poor minds and their poor spirit would be so deluded, they would not know the truth from a lie. They would not know the truth from a lie. The world in which we live is irrelevant to you and I. When we live in the Spirit, we live for the higher things of our life. We live for our Father and Jesus. We seek their praise, not the praise of this world. Who gives a damn if anybody in this world approves of you? What matters and all that's important is that your Father and Jesus the Christ approve of you.
That's living in spirit. Evil people and evil beings cannot comprehend the truth because there is no truth in them, because they do not have this spirit. They do not have this force, this active force that lives in them. They deny and reject our Father's word and his teachings because his word is not in them. John 8:47, he that is of God hear God's words. Ye therefore hear them not, because ye are not of. There's no accident in the day, time, and hour and where you were born. Your Father chose that. There are no accidents or mistakes with the one true Father. There is no chance. Everything is by a perfect design with a master planner. Remember these words, tie them about your neck and hold them close, for they are the truth. There are no mistakes, no accidents. There is no chance. The truth from our Father about living in the Spirit. I prayed about this months ago. I wanted to understand what it means to really live in the Spirit. You know, when you read the scriptures, you see it a lot, but what does it really mean? Living in the Spirit is living in a higher way. It is living for our Father. It is denying the flesh. It is seeking the higher and more important things of our life. We must live in the Spirit, and we as individuals and as a family must pray for the wisdom to do so. Now I'm going to read his word and let him move you as he sees fit, and all the glory to our Father and Jesus' mighty name for this. Some verses that I think will help us to understand what we should be doing in these last days. We must learn to live in the Spirit, and I urge you to pray for it. Matthew 16:26, for what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? 1 Corinthians 3:19, for the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God, for it is written, he taketh the wise in their own craftiness. And he does. They think they're smart, they're dumb as a box of rocks. 1 Timothy 6:5, perverse disputings of men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth, supposing that gain is godliness, from such withdraw thyself. But godliness with contentment is great gain. 7, for we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain that we can carry nothing out. And having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. 1 John 2, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. 16, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. Remember, you're spiritual beings, and you're going back. You're here to do the work, and you will live forever. 1 John 4, and every spirit, notice it says spirit, and every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come, and even now already is it in the world. 4, ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. They are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them. We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. 1 John 3:1, behold what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Remember, we are aliens to them. This is their world. 1 John 2:3, and hereby we know him. We do know that we know him if we keep his commandments. He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. Romans 8:1, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Romans 8:6, for to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace, to live in the Spirit. Romans 8:9, but ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of this. Romans 8:14, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Read that again. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God and his daughters. 1 Corinthians 2:10. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yes, the deep things of God. 1 Corinthians 2:10. For what man knoweth the things of a man, except the spirit of a man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. 1 Corinthians 2:12. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. 1 Corinthians 2:13. Which things also we speak not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. 14. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned, they are stunted. 15. But he that is spiritual judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. 1 Corinthians 3:16. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? Galatians 5:16 and 17. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary to one another, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. 1 John 3:24. And he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him, and he in him. And hereby we know that he abide in us by the Spirit which he hath given us. James 4:4. Ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity, which means hatred with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Living in the Spirit, brethren, is living a higher way. It is living for our Father. We deny the flesh. We seek the higher and more important things of this life. We must live in spirit. We must do it, and we must pray for it. When we live in the Spirit and keep our eyes and hearts on Him continually, we can expect to have a perfect peace. It does not matter what the world is doing. It only matters what we are doing through our Father and Jesus. This world is not here for long. Our relationship with our Father through Jesus Christ is for all of eternity. Isaiah 26:3. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusted thee. We're passing through this earth, as I said earlier, on our way back to our Father. We are strangers in this world. We are visitors. We are witnesses. We are representatives of the one true Father. We are here on a mission, and we are on the last mile home. Jesus said, I am from above, you are from beneath. He was speaking to his enemies. Jesus lives in us, as you just read, and we live in him. The Spirit lives in us.